Chemistry in Action. I'm your host, Ramon Miranda. Earlier, we showed you how chemistry has helped us make advances in industry, technology, and even art and fashion. Today, we'll take you on a tour of the laboratory as we look into measurement in chemistry. How important are measurements in chemistry? We'll calculate the answer to this when we return. From the very first moments of our lives, we enter the world of measurement. From being measured, we graduate to making our own measurements. Wherever we go, we are faced with the need to measure. At the marketplace, at home, and in the workplace, measuring has come to be part of our daily routine. In science, quantitative and qualitative observations are important. We do not merely observe how chemicals change color. We also determine how much the color changes. Antoine Lavoisier, considered the father of modern chemistry, was the first to make carefully controlled experiments in chemistry using measurements. Modern science and technology depend on measurement. Thank you. Medical researchers analyze the presence and concentration of chemicals in our body. Measurements of water pollutants tell us how polluted rivers and seas are. To be able to compare figures, there should be a common basis for measurement. The metric system is used throughout the world. In 1960, a practical system of units for scientific use was adopted. We call this system the International System of Units, or simply SI units. The meter and the gram are the most basic SI units. For example, in preparing moisturizing cream in the laboratory, it is important to measure all ingredients accurately and combine these in the proper proportion. Otherwise, the product won't be very good. The materials and equipment we need in this experiment are a balance, beakers, graduated cylinders, alcohol lamp, tripod, wire gauze, steering rod, thermometer, ice, and distilled water. And then the chemicals, potassium carbonate, glycerol, and stearic acid. Our demonstrator, Jenny De Jesus, will now begin her experiment by mixing 1/10 gram of potassium carbonate with 1 milliliter of glycerol and 10 milliliters of distilled water. We heat the mixture to about 80 degrees centigrade. Then, heat 3 grams of stearic acid until it melts. We then pour the potassium carbonate glycerol mixture into the stearic acid, stirring continuously until this mixture takes on a solid paste consistency. We now have our moisturizing cream. At the heart of any experiment is measurement.
Before we continue our discussion on measurement, let's pause for, let me measure the time, 60 seconds. We make many different measurements. Among the common ones made in the laboratory are weight, mass, and volume. Take this block of food. We use a spring balance. Using a spring balance, the block weighs 0.65 newton.
If an astronaut were to bring the same block of wood to the moon, it would weigh only 1/6 as much.
An object's weight depends on how far it is from the center of the Earth. This is why chemists prefer to measure mass rather than weight.
Mass is the amount of matter in an object. Unlike weight, mass does not change from one place to another. One of the most basic techniques your students should learn is to measure mass accurately. Standard for a kilogram mass is a piece of platinum iridium alloy kept at the International Bureau of Weights and Measures in France.
That standard has almost exactly the same mass as this. The kilogram is a standard SI unit for mass, but in the laboratory, chemists usually work with smaller amounts of materials.
For this reason, we commonly use a gram, a thousandth of a kilogram.
When we teach our students how to measure mass, we teach them to use standard masses for comparison. Jenny will show us how to determine the mass of this mango using a platform balance.
The double beam balance is scaled in 1/10 gram divisions to a maximum of 10 grams. The smallest scale division is 1/10 gram, as shown in the lower beam. This means that the balance is sensitive to 1/10 of a gram. This particular balance can read to 10 grams without additional masses. It can measure the mass of objects up to 2,000 grams or 2 kilos using additional standard masses. We start to use the balance by arresting the beam and pans. Make sure that the rider is at zero. The pointer should be either at the midpoint or swinging equally to the left and to the right. If the swings are not balanced, turn the adjustment screw until you observe equal swings. Place the mango on the center of the left pan. Move the rider to balance the object. If the rider mass is not enough, place an approximate mass or masses until they balance the object. There are other types of balances which differ in sensitivity. They are operated in the same principle that the mass of the object
is compared with standard masses. The analytical balance is the most sensitive. It can measure as small a mass as 1/10 of a milligram.
Another quantity we often measure in the laboratory is volume, especially that of liquids.
The SI unit for volume is a cubic meter. Ordinarily, we use the metric unit of volume, which is a liter. But in most chemistry experiments, we measure volume in milliliters. The glassware's most commonly used to measure volume are the graduated cylinder, volumetric flask, the pipette, and the burette. Graduations on laboratory glassware differ widely in accuracy depending on their use. Pipettes and burettes are calibrated to deliver certain exact volumes of liquid. These glassware are marked TD, which means to deliver. Graduated cylinders and volumetric flasks are calibrated to contain exact volumes of liquid. Of the two types of glassware, the volumetric flask is more precise. These are marked TC, which means to contain.
You should not confuse TC and TD. In the same way, we should not use one kind of glassware for the other. If you do so, you will not get an accurate measurement, since a small amount of liquid may cling to the TC glassware and therefore will deliver a smaller amount than the exact volume that you need. Calibration is usually done at 20 degrees Celsius. As much as possible, we use this glassware at or near this calibration temperature. Otherwise, we will not measure volumes accurately. The most common apparatus for routine measuring of volumes of liquids is a graduated cylinder. The smallest scale division in a 10 ml cylinder is 1/10 of a milliliter. For the 100 ml, it is 1 milliliter. Which of the two do you think will give you a more accurate reading of volume? Most liquids, including water, wet a glass and produce a meniscus, which is curved downward. For clear liquids, hold the cylinder at eye level and read the lower meniscus. If the liquid is opaque, read the upper meniscus. Mercury has a meniscus which is curved upward. Reading the meniscus inconsistently will give you the wrong volume.
A pipette delivers a definite volume of liquid more accurately than a graduated cylinder. We use a rubber suction bulb to draw the liquid into the pipette. This protects the user and prevents contamination of the liquid being measured. The burette is a tall and narrow calibrated glass tube with a stopcock fitted at the bottom for controlling the flow of the liquid. It is used in titration. Titration is a procedure by which we determine the volume of a solution that reacts completely with an exact volume of another solution. One solution has a known concentration, while that of the other is unknown. Another apparatus commonly used in the laboratory is a volumetric flask. This flask can be filled with an exact volume of liquid marked on the neck of the flask. They are used for making solutions of exact, known volumes. Notice that volumetric flasks come in different sizes.
We have just discussed how quantitative and qualitative observations are important in science. We showed you how to measure weight, mass, and volume. We hope this episode on measurement measures up to our objective of enhancing education in an interesting way. Be with us in the next edition of Chemistry in Action. This has been your host, Ramon Miranda, saying good day.